First, I want to say it's really stimulating to be here for me and to listen about something else than bacteriophages. But you need to know a bit more about phages because we haven't heard enough about them until now. So before my talk, I want to mention that I'm working in this very nice place. It's just next to the Versailles Chateau in France. You may know that this is really the twin chateau to the chateau that is standing here in Peterhof. And it's incredible for a French to be here in Russian, for me the first time, and see how things are quite similar between these two distantly related countries. I really enjoy my stay here. So in this Michaelis Institute, we are 300 people working on microbes and focusing more or less on the microbes we have in the gut, but not only, also on food microbiology. And in this institute, it's only my little team of 10 people working on bacteriophages. And what I tried to do for this talk, I'm not a bioinformatician, I'm a biologist, I tried to add all the experience I've got with bioinformatics through the years, because when you work with phages, you're obliged to do some bioinformatics. You'll know why. So, why? Because bacteriophages and their genes and their genomes, they are just different. And in what sense? First, you should imagine that phages have been there mutating and evolving for the last 4 billion years together with the bacteria, but in fact at a higher speed. And this speed of evolution has been so high that the homology signals are sometimes almost erased. And if you look at a phage genome, it's common to get 80% of genes with unknown function. And what we have seen across the years is that proteins with similar function can share as little as 10% identity. So you'll tell me, how can you say two proteins are homologs when they have so little, and I'll try to show you why there are now tools that allow you to do that. And also, the second difficulty is phage genomes are sometimes mosaic. Here I'm trying to explain what it means, taking a picture from an old paper, 2002. If you compare these two phage genomes, what you see is a gene-by-gene comparison, and above a background of, let's say, 30% amino acid identity, you have some regions shared by phages that can be as high as 95% identity. Everything looks as if these two genomes exchanged quite recently this block of genes. And this makes genome reconstitution, genome reconstruction out of reads a bit more difficult than for bacterial genomes. So my talk will have two parts. I will first show you how we can adapt distant homology search tools to annotate phage genes. And I will, so this will be mainly a review of published papers and also some recent results. And in my second part, it will be completely new data showing how, by cultivating phages from viromes and sequencing their genomes, we can compare these results to what we get when we reconstruct contigs out of viral reads. So, for this first part, all my talk will be based on this very nice tool called HHSearch. It's impossible to pronounce. But it's a tool dating from 2005 and developed by Söding. We already heard his name. He is really a great guy. He's making plenty of good things for phage biology. What it makes is a pairwise alignment of profiles from multiple alignments. So it's a kind of square alignment. How does it work? If you have a given protein and its close relatives here, you can make a kind of a alignment profile of your alignment, and you can also guess secondary structures out of this first protein. Now you do the same for a second protein. You have here the logo, it's not as clear as for the first protein. You have some secondary structures. And if you align these two profiles with HH search, you manage to get a relationship between this protein of an unknown function to this one, which maybe has some function. And how does it work? It just takes the best pieces of homology between the two profiles, and it also relies quite heavily on the secondary structure predictions. But it is not as strict on secondary structure prediction as the tools that you can use to reconstruct 3D structures, which usually stop aligning as soon as your alpha helix or beta sheet is not a good length. Here it's more tolerant to length changes. And what is very important is it gives you a probability that the match corresponds to some distant homology. And we really rely a lot on this probability to make our guesses. So we developed three tools based on HH search. The first one was really to try to get some new annotations. And for this, because the tool is taking some time to make the alignments, we needed to pre-compute all the profile-to-profile alignments for a given set of fate proteins. At the time, it was only 90,000 proteins. It was based on a very good database called Acclaim here. And then, because HH search is predicting very distantly related signals, we wanted to confirm the predictions by using Synteny to validate visually what HH search could have predicted. So first, I give you a glimpse for just a while about what is a phage. So a phage is made of a head, a neck, and a tail. Most of the phages of a bacteria have a tail. You have the DNA inside the head, and then you have the tail fibers. And what is very nice, if you look at the genome, very often the genes are organized by functional modules, meaning all the genes for the head are together, the neck are just next to the head genes, then you have the tail genes, and I've been trying to use the same color code all over, green for the head, blue for the tail, and so on. And here, in another region of the genome, you have all the genes involved in DNA replication. And here, lysis. Okay, so we decided we wanted to make HH search, homology search, combined with Synteny display. And in fact, what has always been a very great inspiration for me is the tool called, Gene Neighborhood, if you know this tool, in JGI. How does it work? You enter a few genes from a few genomes you want to look at. Here, let's say you want to look at the RECK gene. And what it shows you is a neighborhood of the gene with a color code to allow you to recognize that there is Synteny. And you can probably see with me that there is a very nice Synteny around the RECK gene in all these bacilli. But now, if you do the same kind of query in JGI with a prophage region, so a region of the bacterial chromosome that is made of a phage, and here I took the BET gene, it's an homologous recombination genes of a phage, what you can see is around the BET genes, you have only uncolored genes. This means there was no homology found for all the genes that are neighboring this one, although, as you can see, they look a bit the same. They have the same size, the same position. So it looks as if the BLAST tool that is behind this display is not able to catch the homology signal. And this is exactly why we wanted to shift to distant homology search. So this is what we made with the Phagonaut interface. So how does it work? It contains, as I said, 90,000 proteins. some of them of archaeal viruses. It makes a profile for each of these proteins, and then it makes an intra-phage world HH search comparison. Okay, all these phage proteins are compared two by two, thanks to their profiles. And also what we do for each protein is a comparison to PFAM. And we display the result in the context of the neighborhood. And we wanted to make the tool a bit flexible because we didn't know at all what would be the good probability threshold for HH search. So the user can decide which level of probability he wants to use and also the number of genes he wants in the neighborhood. What you have to realize is that for a probability of 100%, usually the percent identity is only 30%. And what we usually use as a threshold, 90%, this is where identity drops down to 10%. And we still have functional evidence that it's the same function. And what we found is even at 70% probability, we still have some good signal. So now I will give you, okay, this is how you use the interface. You don't need this. You just get the result. And what you see now, if I take the same example of the BET gene, and what you see is nicely colored genes all around. So the context around the BET genes is well conserved. This was no surprise to us, but it was nice to show it. And now what is interesting in this output is also for each of the colored genes, you have all the predictions that we could collect. So the PFAM prediction, it says it's a recti family, which is normal for BET. And the gene bank annotations when there's one, and the acclaim annotation when there's one. Okay? So we were glad, the tool was looking great. Here you see, at this point, you start to get other phages where the same gene is no longer in the same genetical context. Now, I collected the four uses you can make out of such an interface. The first one, of course, is to predict new functions. So this is what we did with this gene in red, which was of an unknown function, but you see, it was PFAM clearly announced it was an SSB, single-strand binding protein. And there was also, at some point here down in the list, a phage, LookNew, in which an annotator had the courage to say it's putative single-strand binding protein. In fact, in the phage world, people tend to under-annotate, contrary to the rest of the world. But this is because it's quite difficult to anyway. So, and what we could do is purify the protein and show it was exactly an S single-strand binding protein. And then, even more interesting, what we could figure out is that this SSB was systematically flanked by a SAC4 recombinase. Here, you see it. And what we could show is that both proteins work together for recombineering. So there was a functional association between these two proteins. So that's the other interesting thing you can do with PhagoNote when you see recurring co-occurrences. We also discovered with this tool that there was a protein called NEC1 that was systematically present in the region of the connector. The connector is connecting the head to the tail of the phage. And I think nobody studied ever this protein, but we should, because it's really always present there. So we almost have the function, but we need to know exactly what it's doing. And also, there was a very interesting protein for me called REF that's present in the P1 phage, and that's a Recce filament-specific nuclease. And the paper, at that time, by Cox, was claiming this was an orphan protein. And with this piece of evidence, you can see that it's not an orphan. We do have other genomes in which, well, synteny is not really conserved, it's true, but you have a good signal of homology with HH search, so I would also suggest to go and dig into these kind of proteins. So I must mention that this phagonaut interface is a closed box. You cannot enter new phage genomes, but with the already characterized phages, you have many new functions that you could dig into and better characterize. And in terms of evolutionary relationships, we were also surprised to find that some Pseudomonas phages, which are quite difficult to annotate, contain genes that are conserved down into these red named phages, which are in fact archaeal viruses. So there are also some relationships between archaeal viruses and phages that you can detect with this tool. And we wanted to go even further, and we took the herpes simplex virus because it was claimed to have homologous recombination genes similar to the one of phages. So we looked and took all the genes of the herpes virus, so it's the first line over there, and we could find very easily for many genes a conserved phage gene. The only thing is that the synteny was not conserved at all. But still, here it's the overall result for envelope, even for envelope proteins. So it's this virus has a huge envelope like this, which phages usually do not have. But even for these proteins, we could find homologs. For the capsid, this is also claimed in many papers that you have capsid genes that are homologous. But the most important category of conserved genes was DNA metabolism, and that was surprising for me and quite interesting. So I will close here for the phagonaut explanation. What we did also out of HHSearch is a phage classifier based on the detection of the neck module genes and on synteny. Here, this site, you can enter your own phage and classify it with it. Okay? How does it work? We have, it's a bit like Phagonaut, we have pre-computed all the head, neck, and tail protein profiles for 1,000 phages. Then the user uploads its own protein, and we start building all the profiles for all the proteins. We compare them to our database and we give a result. If we detect enough homologs at conserved position, and then we classify the phage compared to our reference database. And I give you an example that is a bit surprising to me. It's the Vibrio phage 11895B1, a beautiful name. It has no structural gene annotated. And our classifier allows to tell you it's a myoviridae of type 1, cluster 7. Here you have a map of the genome and where we found all the structural genes. And as you can see, contrary to my rule, they are not at all in a single functional module. They are all over the place. My personal guess is maybe the genome was not very well assembled, but I don't know. We are quite confident that we could figure out where all these proteins were, because in most cases HH search probability was high, except for two of the an adapter and a head closure protein that were more distantly related, but that's typical for these genes. So based on this collection of proteins, we could mention that there was a synteny problem. So the observed intergene distance and the expected intergene distance that we could calculate based on our data set, okay? But nevertheless, we offer a classification of this phage next to Felix O1 in our tree, and we give the scores of identity for all the proteins that we could find to the first three phages, the most closely related. And you see, as I could tell you, that for For some of the proteins, the percent identity goes down to 10%. Okay, and now the third tool we are presently developing, it's not yet published. So the problem with this kind of tools is you constantly need to recalculate profiles for the newly sequenced phages. So this we started to do again and making things a bit differently. We made families of remote autologs, so we call them frogs. And how do we do? So we started from a large collection of phage and prophage proteins. It's tenfold more proteins than in phagonaut. We cluster them together first with a BLASTp. We generate the profiles of the alignments, and then we aggregate these small families in larger families thanks to HH search using a probability cutoff of 90%. And we have a very stringent cutoff on the coverage. This is a point where I a bit disagree with my colleague, François Hainaut. He's very stringent on this place. And I know personally that phage proteins can be very, very different in size and have the same function. But you'll see it's not a problem because then we have a very conservative prediction of protein functions. Because of course we report the annotation we could find in these frogs. And we annotate these frogs, and 26% of the 10,000 frogs of a size larger than 10 members have now an annotation. It's not huge, I was expecting more. But what's good is that you can detect the neighboring frogs by doing a second round of HH search. And you use the p-value 90%, but you remove the coverage stringency. And there we are just in the process of analyzing this kind of results, but I'm sure we are going to propose an annotation for many more proteins thanks to this second round of HH search. So what does it give? Here it's a kind of analysis of what we did, where we made a graph showing for all the main annotations that we get, at which point we can connect them together with this second round of HH search. And what you see, so there is a color code depending on functions, so the head, connector, and the tail proteins, replication, transcription, regulation, etc. And what you see is that most groups group together proteins with the same function. This can be, why are they grouped? Either because one annotation is more general than the other, more like structural protein or head protein, this makes a difference, or because you have fusions of proteins with different function. And this is probably the case, for example, of this yellow one that is in the middle of the blue one. But we were quite pleased with this result, meaning that our annotation strategy was quite faithful. And of course, we are now building the online access to these families of remote autologs, and you can download all the results and make your own annotation strategy based on these families. Yes, and I finish by this example of an output page of this frog. And this is the corner that I like more here. But first I show you, for any given frog, here I took another recombinase. As you have understood, my real interest is in phage recombination. And in this super family of 800 members, what you see is that there are some frogs similar to this family. And among them, this one has no annotation, but it's really closely related, 92% probability. And we are working with a protein from this group, and we are presently showing it has exactly the same function as this one. So it's really a case where we are confident that the neighboring frogs are going to benefit from the annotations. So I conclude from this first part by telling you that distant homology searches are good for helping in phage annotation, but nothing is automatic. We do on purpose. We want biologists to decide by themselves whether they go or not for the experimental validation of the annotations. We have also a site to permit phage classification. It's so successful that we decided now to make a downloadable version, because I mean, we always have to wait for the results. And now we are just building these frog families to help updating families and make new annotations. Now, I will move to the second part, which is probably more interesting for those who assemble genomes here. And you have to know that assembling phages from viral reads is not so easy. Assemblers have been compared with a simulated dataset and real virome datasets, and the most recent paper is this one, to my knowledge. And they show that usually SPADES is one of the most satisfying ones. So what we did is a parallel study on 650 fecal samples of one-year-old children. We wanted first to isolate phages at the bench for these samples on E. coli, because it's an easily tractable species. And second, on the same samples, we wanted to make a virome sequencing and assembly. And we here for you, I will confront the two sets of results. First, I explain to you why it's good to use children samples when you search for E. coli phages. It's because E. coli is really prevalent in children fecal samples. So here it's a total read count of OTUs. And Bacteroides is the first species in this sample, but the second one is E. coli, and the third one is a Fecalibacterium group of species. And the median value for E. coli is 1% of the reads per children are E. coli reads. So if the species is abundant, you expect the phages to be abundant as well. So this is the strategy. So we took the fecal sample. It was only a very small amount, 0.5 grams were given to us. This is an unselected cohort that was used for the study of asthma in Denmark. And what they found in a previous study is that at this time, at 1 year, there was a significant difference between the children diagnosed with asthma and the other ones for some species of the gut, like 8 or 9 species, but some of the most prevalent ones. So they wanted to go deeper into this and study the phages of these fecal samples. So our part of the study consisted in isolating phages, as I told you, on E. coli. Our surprise was that there was only 23% of the samples from which we could isolate coliphages. We expected much more. And the second thing was not really a surprise. It was predicted by many papers. Most of these phages were temperate. We extracted DNA for 32 of them, Illumina sequencing, trimming, assembly. Okay. And the second half of the study, the biggest one that was done in Denmark, from the same virome, they extracted total DNA, made a MDA amplification with Fe29, Illumina sequencing, trimeromatic, dereplication, assembly, cluster at 90% identity because there was too many pontics, and they call this viral OTUs. So the question I address in this talk is, are the genomes that we retrieved here present here? And what are the relative and absolute concentration of these phages? So first, what did we find? So the 32 genomes were covering together 12 species and 8 genera. There was only 2 new species, because E. coli phages are so well known, you know. So that's quite comfortable. You go quite fast with phage genome annotation and everything. Most of them were lambda virus, but there were some also some P2-like and some V5, if you want to remember a few names. I want to show you how Mosaic is the lambda genus or species, I don't know how we should call it. You should know that taxonomy for phages is just an ongoing process. Okay. So here is what we call an easy fig output of pairwise blast N results. When it's red, it's more than 90% identity. So you see there's this region of all the structural genes in green and blue, quite well conserved, except in this phage. And then in the replication module, it's just completely patchy. Okay. And here, just in the middle, a beautiful array of genes encoding for an iron transporter. We were very happy to find that. Okay, and this is to be contrasted. So this is a typical case of a mosaicism. But that this is to be contrasted with virulent phages, which usually are not mosaic at all, and this is an alignment of two T5 we could get from our samples with the sequence T5. You see, it's almost conserved everywhere, very nice, except in the tail fibers, and this has to do with host recognition. So now, the comparison. So what we did is I skip all the way they did the virus reads assemblies, but I mentioned it quite rapidly. So they got this huge number of contigs, and we wanted to know among them whether they could recover our phages. This we just made a blast, and we found the best match for all but two genera. So we were quite happy. There was only two genera that were missing. And we had four situations. Either the match was complete, let's say more than 70% coverage, and this was half of the cases. So for six of the 12 species, we could get really good phages. The second case was a tiny fragment fully included in the phage, meaning, in fact, in the virome assembly, for T4, they could only make a fragment of 6 kb. I will explain you why later. The third situation is a partial match to another full-length lambda. So this is typical with the problems of mosaicism. Here, vertically, you have all the lambda we could find in our isolation. And on the top here, it's the lambda contig that was found in the viral in the viromes. There was only one contig, and in fact, it matched only partially. And my bet is it's matching on the structural genes, of course. But so this is not completely satisfying, but still you can work with this. And then what's happening for the two missing phage species, we have an OTU, but it's a very distant one. So this is one case, ESSI2, and the OTU 5414. Maybe you see here, there is a very faint diagonal. And if you do the Needleman and Wunsch alignment, it's 57% identity on 20 kb only. And this is the case of Stevie. It's a bit better. It's 64% identity on 35 kb. And you see better the diagonal here. So this is probably also a difficulty for assembly, is when you have so many mismatches and divergence between the reads, if you have a mix of two phages that are too divergent. Now, the next question, of course, what was really interesting for me is to look how often you can find these E. coli phages that we isolated in single samples across all the children. And interestingly, in 20% of the samples, there was more than 100 reads per kb per million reads. So we were wondering whether we had only 20% of the virions in which we could isolate coliphage because we were bad at isolating them, or was it a real scarcity of the phages? And I think with this result, it's matching quite well. It's probably meaning that the phage concentration in the fecal sample is not so high for E. coli, and so you cannot retrieve them by growth because it's too low concentration. I'm showing you here the graph only for the 44 samples in which there was at least globally more than 1,000 reads per kb. And what you can see, I hope, quite clearly, if you look at the first bars, is in every sample there is mainly a boost, a burst of one phage. So you have here, it's color-coded, so this sample has a huge amount of reads to the Stevie relative, the distant relative of Stevie. And in the second bar, it's also a boost of the gluteny phage. Second, third is also a gluteny. Here, you have more diversity, you have four different phages, but otherwise, if you read all these bars, you'll see that most of the case, you have just a burst of a single phage in a single sample. And what we found also is that the T4OTU, it's not this reddish one, it's another red, I think it's, let me remember, I mean, it's a very small amount, I think here is some T4. So the reason why we could get only a small contig is because it was a very low abundance in our children. The lambda is this clear blue. It's more prevalent, you can find it in quite many samples all around. And okay, so this is quite inspiring now if you think in terms of biology, what does it mean? And the last thing I wanted to show you, because we were really surprised and didn't expect that, is that we could make some quantitative estimates. On the left part of this slide, what you see is how we estimated the phage counts just by plating. On the left part is the temperate phage that we could recover. On the right part is the virulent one. And you see there is a significant increase of the titer for the virulent one compared to the temperate. But overall, it's quite low. It's 10 to the 3 PFU per gram for the temperate, the median value, and 10 to the 4 for the virulent. Okay, and now, because we have these values, we go back to the sample and look in the virome how many reads we could count on each of these phages. And that's here, you have less dots because they were not all always found in the context of the sample. Okay, we have missing data, but for the data we have, it's quite nice. Here is the curve that's drawn between, so here are the read counts and here's the plaque forming unit, and you see there is a clear positive relationship with a correlation value of 60%. And I draw here the bisectrice, and what you see is in fact mostly the pink dots are a bit outside the bisectrice, and these are the temperate phages. And as you remember, most temperate are lambda phages, and the lambda phages are those for which we do not have the best contigs. So probably the estimate is not so good. But for the virulent phages, we really have quite a nice linear correlation, which if we take the bisectrice here, we say for 1,000 PFU, you have 10 reads per kb per million reads. You see? So you start to make an estimation of how many phage you have in your sample, which from a biology perspective starts to tell you, are they going to kill or not? And if the multiplicity of infection is low, you probably have not so many chances that the phage will impact the ecosystem. But in the cases, as I showed you, where you have so high counts of the phage, it probably affected the population. Okay. I think with this I'm done. Yeah, a few conclusions for this part. So what we found is half of the coliphage retrieved were present as nearly full contigs in Spades assemblies. It corresponds to the most abundant and the less mosaic ones. So there is still room for improvement to assemble mosaic phages. There's probably a problem with divergent genomes. And there is a surprising good fit between mapping counts and PFU per gram. We can say that we isolated phages if the RPKM was above 100, which would convert into 1,000 PFU per gram. This leads us to conclude that coliphages may not be so abundant in children's fecal samples. For two reasons, we got 20% of the samples that were positive for coliphages, and we have average values that are quite low, between 10 to the 4 and 10 to the 5 per gram. This amounts to a maximum MOI of 10 to the minus 3. But of course, this is a story for E. coli, and we don't know yet what's going to be the result for other species of the gut. Okay? And now my thanks, many thanks first to the members of my teams who worked on these projects. On the left part, you have the collaborators on all the HH search studies. Mostly it was done together with Raphaël Guerrois, and more recently we started a project with François Hinault. And on the right part, it's a very nice GPI project that we had. You know, it's a kind of European project that are not too big. So there were only four teams working together and quite efficiently. This COPSAC clinic who made a large cohort, the University of Copenhagen, who did all the virome sequencing and assembly, and the University of Laval with Sylvain Moineau, who helped with phage genomes sequencing and annotation. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you for the amazing talk. We have some time for questions. Thank you for your talk. I have two questions. One question is about the situation when you didn't find the similar virus in the space in the second assembly. Have you tried to map reads? Because the identity between the sequences was too low,
yes,
for those sequences to be merged by space. So possibly there's something. So what about the reads?
I should look back into the results. We've done it also, mapping the reads directly on the phage that we got, but I don't remember the result. I'm sure we are going to find some children in which the phage is present, of course.
Okay. And the second question, whether you, for your super families of the viral genes, can one family belong to multiple super families because of the picture that seems that they can?
So, yes, because of fusions, some phage proteins are fused. Like you can have a recombination recombinase together with a nuclease fused together. Okay.
Thank you for the talk. How did you distinguish between template?
Oh yeah, good question. Yes. So in fact, because we could grow the phages, so the first way to distinguish is the kind of plaque you get. If it's a virulent one, it's a clear plaque. If it's temperate, it's turbid. We are more specialists of temperate phages, so for the temperate, we had no difficulty to decide it was a temperate just by the plaque aspect. For the virulent one, we were surprised to see that depending on the host, it can make a clear or a turbid plaque. So it was not so easy to decide. So we went to the results of the genomes, and because coliphages are so well known, once you have the genome, you know if it's a temperate or a virulent, just because it has been studied for so long. And there is some hallmark genes, there is an integrase, but you have to know that a temperate phage does not necessarily have an integrase, because they can also live as plasmids, like P1 is a plasmid or whatever. So there is no definitive rule to assign a phage to a temperate or a virulent by a single gene. You have to look at several of them. There's a famous one, a phage now of the gut, which is called the Krass phage. Maybe you heard of it. People seem to think it's a virulent, but I'm quite sure it's going to be a temperate. In fact, it has no integrase. But if you look at the genome, you have two genes of replication rep. It's probably one for the vegetative replication and the other one for the virulent replication. It's typical of P1, for example. So I discuss with people working on these phages and say, why are you saying it's virulent? And they say, no, in fact, we don't know. And now that the Krass phage is extending, some of them have an integrase. So yeah, it's a real question. It's not always so easy to decide, but for E. coli, it's quite easy.
So on your frogs, sorry, I'm yes. going to go because that's mm-hmm. a lot of interest to me for protein families. So I think when you were doing your hierarchical clustering of frogs, it looked like the transcription regulation was quite often being quite promiscuous with these clusters. So just eyeballing this, the yellow ones, the transcription regulators seem to appear in lots of different clusters. So the question is, first of all, why do you think that may be? And the second thing is I think you're using uniform thresholds for doing this clustering. And
yes.
You found we use individual cluster thresholds for every single family because of
that.
So I was wondering if you've looked at whether there's a dynamic threshold issue that should apply.
Yeah, we should look at that. It's a good point. You point on the problematic family. In fact, if you look carefully, there's, let's say...
But like up the top left, in amongst all of the lysis, you've got another transcription.
Yeah, it's true.
And then sort of a 12
So, here also. We should look at the threshold. Maybe that's the explanation. Because you do not expect a transcriptional regulator to be fused with anything.
Exactly.
I agree. Thank you.
A question related to the paper. If you look at the assembled data, can you detect if the virus is integrated or in a plasmid form? Is it possible looking at the data of the assembled?
Well, if you find an integrase, it's easy. And integrases are quite easy to detect in genomes. Okay? If you do not find it, the only solution is either it's a temperate with a plasmidic form, and then you need other cues like, is there a transcriptional regulator? But some virulent ones also have some, so there's no definitive answer. So unfortunately, it's more difficult for plasmidic temperate phages just by the genome to be sure it's going to be a temperate, unfortunately. That's my, yeah. And you have to be aware that a lot of phages are plasmidic temperate. For example, if you look at the community of people working on plasmids, like in Bacillus cereus, where there's a lot of plasmids with all this crystal protein and so on, they say to you, oh, this strain has 7 plasmids. This one is a phage, this one is a phage, this one... For them, it's not a problem. They just know that some of their plasmids are phages. But in other communities, people just ignore the fact that phages can be plasmidic. So I hope with the time we will clarify all this with the databases on plasmids and phages. It will become more clear.
Thank you.
I'm not sure my answer is satisfying.
Did you find some quantum that were chimeric with viral seconds
and plasmid sequence?
Seconds?
No.
That would give you, okay, this is integrated, and quantum which are really independent, and we give you the information, okay, maybe it's more in a plasmid.
No, this we didn't.
The geometry of the signal than the sequence itself.
Yeah. No. I know why you're asking this, but I don't know so well the viral part of this dataset because it's new. We just look at it now. From what I understood, they have some quantics that are purely bacterial. They can eliminate, or maybe they are plasmids and so on, and some that are purely viral. But I don't think they detected the hybrid kind. Thank you. I don't know if this is this new room, but we have many more questions. It's nice.
I have a question regarding the picture polyphage concentration versus virus.
Oh, yeah? Hey.
I'm just curious, there are four points that look like we are bias. Anything special about this?
Hello, what is your question specifically?
We see four points that look like to be applied, they are colored different.
Ah, yeah, this one. So I colored them because they were higher in concentration and I looked, but this is not in this slide, whether the bacterial concentration was also higher, which would explain why you have more phages, because they grow on more bacteria. And this is not exactly the case. These phage samples are not coming from fecal samples in which E. coli was more abundant. So it's a bloom. They just bloomed in there. Probably in this case, the phage really found its target bacteria. Probably the difficulty in the gut is there's so many species that before the phage can find its host, it's a lot of chance. I see.